John Kasza here from St. James Parish, continuing our series, and this particular one is Sexual Morality Part 2. And in this particular video, we're going to explore a little bit more of the Church's teaching, especially in regards to homosexuality and behavior. As I said in Part 1, there are three aspects we need to consider: orientation, activity, and lifestyle. Now, with regard to the person that feels that he or she is oriented towards members of the same sex, that is, they have a homosexual orientation, the Church recognizes that they too are special, unique human beings. They are holy. They are created in the image and likeness of God. They have gifts and talents. They are considered children of God. And that's something we have to remember. The Church always looks at persons as being holy. We look at persons as being in the image of God. We look at persons as unique. However, as persons, we sometimes make mistakes and we sometimes do things which go contrary to what God has intended. And that's why you'll often see in the Church's catechism the term that certain activity is disordered. Again, the activity or the lifestyle is disordered, not the person. The Church never says homosexual persons are disordered. The Church does say that certain activities are disordered, such as masturbation, pornography. Okay. Inappropriate touching and sexual intercourse outside marriage. Okay. These activities are disordered, and these would be disordered for a homosexual, a heterosexual, even someone who's celibate, someone who's taken a promise of to live the lifestyle of being a vowed religious or a priest. You may have heard a few recently that there was a priest of the Vatican who came out publicly and said that he was in a relationship with another man. And the newspapers all went crazy because they said, here the Church is, you know, kicking him out because he's gay. No. The fact is, he would have been kicked out if he had had a girlfriend or if he had had a secret marriage. He had promised to take a vow of celibacy. He took that vow. And yet he deliberately chose to break it. He deliberately chose to say, I'm not going to follow that. And that's why he got removed. It wasn't because he was gay. Now, the issue is this, that certain activity is considered disordered. So homosexual activity falls under this category here, sexual intercourse outside of marriage. And the majority of homosexual persons with whom I've worked usually get together because they feel a need to have a person to love. And, you know, everybody needs someone to love them. Everybody needs someone to care about. But where the disorder happens is when they transfer that love into some kind of physical activity which mirrors or mimics the activity which a heterosexual couple in marriage undergoes or entertains. And so the Church really says that sexual intercourse outside of marriage for heterosexuals, homosexuals, or celibates is disordered. A lifestyle which is contrary to either marriage or celibacy is also disordered. So if a man had multiple female partners over the course of his life and he considered himself straight or considered himself to be a playboy, a man about town, the church would say his lifestyle choice is disordered. If a woman had multiple female partners and went around celebrating her gay lifestyle, the church would consider that to be disordered. Again, the activity and the lifestyle are disordered, not the person. If a priest or a religious woman were to have a big collection of pornography, or were to engage in masturbatory activity, the church would say that those people are living a lifestyle that is disordered. They are engaging in activities which are disordered. They are contrary to the law of nature. They violate our relationship with God. They violate our relationship with other human beings. Because what those kinds of things do, masturbation, pornography, inappropriate touching, is they use another human being and make them an object for our pleasure. So basically the church really focuses on two lifestyles, that we are called to either live a lifestyle that is marriage between a man and a woman, or celibacy, which invites us to refrain from sexual activity, whatever that sexual activity may be, with another human being, with oneself, with a computer, whatever. So these are the two lifestyles that the church really focuses as being ordered and focuses as being, you know, in God's intent, what God intended for creation. From the beginning of time, God made them male and female, and he made them as partners for life. And God intends that a man should leave his mother and father and join with his wife. Now, in some cases, people are single and are celibate and refrain from sexual activity, and they try to live their life in a life of service. That too is acceptable in the eyes of God and the eyes of the church. What should we do if we encounter someone who is homosexual? Above all, love them. We are called to love. We are called to pray. And we're called to witness to them. That is, we are called to invite them in a very loving way to seek out Jesus Christ, to recognize that God is calling them to himself. We witness to everyone. These things are not unique because of their homosexual. These are to every person. We call to love everyone, pray for everyone, and witness to everyone about the love of Jesus Christ. For someone who's homosexual, the worst thing that we can do as Christians is to reject them or to say that they're bad people or to condemn them. We are not to judge. We are not to criticize. We are called to invite them to conversion and invite them to experience the love of God, and then let God do the rest. Let God transform them. Let God heal them. Let God call them to himself in his own special way. So as we continue in our quest to be good Christians, we remember that sexual activity and sexuality is a gift from God, designed to procreate the human race, designed to unify the couple, and designed to build up society. And so things that do not do that should be avoided. Things that are selfish, things that are, you know, directing things to ourself or making others an object for our pleasure, are to be avoided. Because we ultimately look at each person as a gift. And each person is an opportunity to encounter God himself. So I encourage all of us to read what the Catechism says, and to above all, love, pray, and witness to one another about the wonderful things that God is doing in the world around us.